The first thing I'm going to do is abdicate. So I'm no longer the moderator. We're just going to have a conversation. The second thing is I'll tell you the same thing I tell my students, which is that everybody wants growth and nobody wants change. And you got to take them as a package. So what we're going to talk about today is both growth and change. The other framing comment comes from a colleague of mine, George Akerlof, who's a Nobel Prize winning economist. And George saw a sign in France, a road sign at a train crossing that said, the translation is, careful, one train may hide another. And that's the real theme of today's discussion, that there are at least two distinct trends that are driving things in the world right now. We're going to try calling one Moore's Law and just use that as the shorthand for anything related to technological change. So transistors, fiber, genomics, you name it. The other is globalization, that even with no changes along those dimensions, taking things that we used to do in cities or nations and now scaling it to a global scale is changing scale, changing markets, and is also an important part of the diffusion of knowledge that already exists. So we'll use technology and, the Moore's Law and globalization, right. Moore's Law and globalization as our two framing concepts, but I may forget it within another minute, or we may choose some other heading shortly thereafter. In terms of the framework or the format here, there is apparently a way for you to submit questions to the iPad that I have in front of me. So if you have questions, and you can send them up, please do. We will set aside some time so that if you want to just say a question out loud, there'll be mics and you can give us those questions. So let me just kick it off by saying that for many of the kinds of issues that we look at, where we're seeing both change and growth, these two different forces can be quite important. Think about, for example, inequality, wage inequality, or the focus of that economist cover. You can think of that as something that's being driven by Moore's Law, that we're getting robots that can do jobs that people used to do, so there's less demand for low-skill labor, but more demand for, say, the high-skill jobs of building the robots or maintaining them. But you can also think about this as being something that's driven by globalization, that in one very early stage, most of the things that were manufactured in the United States were manufactured by people who lived here, but now there's this worldwide market of people who are willing to work in a factory, and we can now outsource production anywhere in the world. So there's a big increase in the supply of people willing to work in jobs that involve things like eye-hand coordination. That change in increase in the supply is naturally putting pressure worldwide on wages. So this is the kind of the illustration of how both Moore's Law and globalization can be operating when we think about something like inequality. I'll give one other example. If you think about urbanization, in rich countries, it's very compelling to think about things like, what's a self-driving car going to do to how we move around within cities? So that's a kind of a Moore's Law effect. But for most of the world, there's this huge just diffusion, copying of what's already done in cities, even things as simple as laying out the roads or putting in a water system. So an enormous amount of the spread of urbanization around the world is not this smart city innovation, but it's actually just diffusing things that already work. So with those two as just kind of illustrations of how these two forces interact, let me turn it over to Jana and just ask, you know, what issues are you thinking about, and does this framework work, or shall we move on to some better framework?
Great introduction, Paul. Absolutely. Yeah. It does work for me, and it works very well, because when you think of growth, we actually, when we looked at global growth in the last 50 years and the next 50, we divided it into two parts. One of them was innovation, broadly understood, but Moore's Law is a reasonable proxy for that. And on the other hand, diffusion, which is adoption of the better practices that have already been proven someplace elsewhere, and adopting them more broadly. So that works very well for me. You innovate and then you diffuse it globally. And there's a lot of work to be done on the latter, even when we talk about innovation. We estimate that 3/4 of the growth opportunities in productivity in the next 10 years will come from the latter. There's still a lot of work to be done. But I think what we need to be really careful is that we don't use this shorthand that sounds so simple as a too simple mental model as we think of how the world is going to evolve in the future. Technology is not just more slow, it is much less unpredictable, particularly today. It's so much faster. Innovations are happening at a much faster speed than they ever did before. Adoption rates are much faster, and costs are coming down dramatically differently. I could give you many examples of each one of them, but let me just pick one, which is the Human Genome Project. It took 13 years and $3 billion to decode the sequence, the genome. Right now, we can buy kits for a few hundred dollars that can do it in a few hours. So when you start thinking about that dramatically different speed and the breadth on where the innovation is happening, everything becomes much more unpredictable, and we have much less time to react. And that really makes it a different world. It is much more uncertain, and the skills you need are to kind of parse it out and see what technologies, what changes will matter, and where will they matter. And on that front, just as a last thing on that question, if you think of, for example, drones, do you know what is the biggest commercial market for drones in the that we expect in the next 10 years? By far, it's agriculture, by a wide margin. And beyond that, it is oil and gas.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear. It's what?
Agriculture.
Oh, yeah.
Precision
yeah.
Agriculture, measuring, fielding, sensing the fields, and being able to optimize your production. Same thing in oil fields and gas fields. You're basically monitoring the pipes, et cetera. This is not what most people think, because we read about the deliveries that are coming to your mailbox. So thinking about technology and how it's going to change the world, if we take the mental models of Moore's Law going forward, I think we won't be ready for the changes that are going to happen.
And you know, we actually are already seeing self-driving tractors being deployed.
Absolutely.
Sooner than self-driving cars. So ag may be ahead on several dimensions.
85% of Japanese agriculture is actually fertilized by drones.
Yeah.
Today?
Yes. What do you think?
I learned something new, and this is supposed to be what I do for a living. I think my two watchwords these days are that the future is closer than it appears, and that anyone who tells you they know where things are heading, even over a relatively short time frame, like 5 or 10 years, is either lying to you or lying to themselves. We are in deeply weird and unpredictable times, mainly in a good direction. I'm a mindful optimist about the world we're heading into. And we can get lulled by Moore's Law.
Yeah.
Because it's this remarkably consistent observation. I think, you know how someone once said that Darwin's theory was the best idea anyone ever had? I think Moore's Law is the best prediction anyone ever made. Gordon Moore made it 50 years ago. It has been astonishingly consistent ever since then. You hear that it's running out of steam. We've got a lot of run rate left on Moore's Law. And when I say Moore's Law, I mean that kind of broadly. It's not just transistors for a dollar. It's memory and processing and bandwidth and storage and sequencing human genetics. All these things are getting better at a ridiculous exponential clip. That's going to go on for a long time. And that gives us this weird cornucopia to work with. My favorite illustration, you know, we've all heard, this is actually accurate, that this thing is the supercomputer of a generation ago. That's true. An even better one that I heard, you know the greeting cards that you can buy that open up and they play a tune? One of those greeting cards has more computing capacity than the Allied forces did during World War II. This takes us into completely new territory, and we cannot predict what the smart people are going to do with these new tools that are getting so much more numerous and so much more powerful all the time. Paul, this is something I've gotten from your work. Mm-hmm. The thing we really underestimate, we lowball Moore's Law like crazy. The thing we really underestimate is innovation and the ability of geeks to take building blocks and recombine them in really, really powerful ways. I don't think anyone here would have predicted that a bunch of cryptocurrency nerds would get together and put together this, you know, the currency called Bitcoin, okay, but this thing underneath it called a blockchain, which is this globally distributed ledger where a transaction happens if the internet says it did. Right? This is this crazy, stupid idea, except it kind of works, and it might affect the fortunes of a lot of the companies that we see in this room over the next 5 to 10 years. So I find it almost impossible to lowball innovation these days.
Let me just make a point about this notion that technology is not always as smooth as, say, Moore's Law. I'm just obsessed with cities these days. Right now, we're in a period where the actual technologies we've used for transportation, which are really the heart of interaction in a city, it's how you move people around, how you move goods around, those technologies have really been quite stable for about 100 years. And yep. we're on the cusp of a period where everything may change very rapidly. So it's not a good general model to think of as steady, cumulative Moore's Law kind of process. It could be more like what we see in biology, where you have kind of an equilibrium yep. where there's a little bit of incremental change, and then suddenly something punctures it, and you get a whole Cambrian explosion of new technologies.
My favorite TED talk this year was by the head of Google's autonomous car project, and it's been pretty clear for a while. I rode in one of Google's driverless cars in 2012, took a very weird ride down Highway 101 in California, and I came back and I told some of my computer science colleagues about that at MIT, and they said, look, driving down a highway is actually not that hard to do, because it's a relatively stable environment. It's in the city with pedestrians where things get crazy, where for the next decade, we're not going to see autonomous cars able to handle that kind of thing. I'm not making this up. Chris Urmson is his name. He did a TED talk this year. He showed a video of what happened when the Google autonomous car, the current generation, was driving through the streets of Mountain View, and a woman in a wheelchair chased a duck into the street with a broom. This was not something it was programmed to handle at all. And the car kind of went, oh, okay, that's weird, and didn't run over even the duck, and the situation normalized and the car drove on. So this old certainty about, you know, more unstable environments are not going to see this wave of technology, I just don't think that's true anymore.
Let me build on that one. I love the example of autonomous cars because it gives
you don't
exactly
have a better story than the duck.
Let me try. Let me try, though, because let's think about, in a way, when we are trying to really predict to the future on what happens with the driverless cars, I think we all can pretty much guess what it's going to be do in the kind of direct effect, if you want. I think most of us can't wait to have them and be on the back seat and have the productive time. We can also perhaps predict pretty easily what the demand is, what the impact is on car demand. We'll have more sharing when my babysitter and myself can share a car, and we'll have more sharing apps. But when you start thinking about the third order spillover effects elsewhere, that's when things get exciting. So for example, how much space in Manhattan is spent on parking right now? How about if our driverless cars can just drop us off at work, at home, at the gym, wherever you want to be at any moment? We won't need parking in Manhattan. We basically release a lot of assets that are the most valuable assets in the world today in the biggest cities. And that can be a real transformative thing on the city's world that Paul and I actually spent some time on that as well, which is really exciting to think about. And I think we are just starting to imagine what that would mean. And that's just one example. Let's think further. As a parent of a teenager, it's very clear that the best news about driverless cars is that we'll probably have fewer teenage accidents that lead to death. But if you are thinking about organs that need to be transplanted, that's not great news. In a way, we'll have a very different supply and demand balance pretty soon again. So in many ways, when you start pushing just the simple example of driverless cars, there's going to be many, many markets that will be influenced in a way that we can't really imagine. And that's exactly the uncertainty, the opportunities, and who can start imagining the world when things start starting on different fields at different times. That will be a skill we are not necessarily as good as we probably need to be.
So let me link this back to the globalization piece, that one of the effects of scale is that the returns from an innovation are much higher. They're basically proportional to the number of people or the amount of income that you can get access to. So when Google is making investments now, they can think about selling those cars not just in North America or North America and Europe, but in the part of the world where most people are going to be, Asia. So that we actually held a conference last week with Google and a variety of people talking about how different the circumstances are in Asia and what kinds of features of this new technology are going to be well suited for use in Asia. The city street space is incredibly valuable real estate everywhere in the world. So to the extent that these cars economize on the real estate that they consume, they're going to be very valuable. But wages are much lower in most of Asia, so that the advantages from having economizing on the use of the time of the driver won't be as large. But the underlying point is part of why it makes so much sense for so many firms to make these huge investments in discovering new things is that they can sell them now to a worldwide market. So the globalization is feeding back into more rapid technological change, more racing to try and capture these big opportunities.
Can I bounce a naive hypothesis off you? One of the great opportunities when you've got the world leader on globalization is you can bounce your stupid globalization ideas off him and see what happens.
As long as I can give a stupid answer.
Fine, we'll race to
fight
the bottom.
Fire with fire.
So my kind of bumper sticker way to talk about the impact of this technological shift is that, speaking parochially as an American, I would kind of rather have our problems than anybody else's problems for the next decent chunk of time going forward. Because when the incredible cost declines of Moore's Law meet the rising wages in developing world and countries like China, I think that's going to be a really interesting collision and a challenging one for companies that have come up on a, to oversimplify, a wage arbitrage economic strategy. Yeah. What do you think is going to happen as that collision takes place?
Yeah, I think that there's kind of two dimensions. One is we're farther down a path of, you know, for example, we outsourced shoe manufacturing, you know, a long time ago, and you know we've been upskilling and educating, and so we're farther down that path and have some experience with that compared to our our some nations for whom this is all very new. So, for example, the high school movement in the 20s in the United States, that we should have universal high school education. You know, that was a radical, world-changing kind of idea back then. We just take it for granted. And we're probably moving towards some kind of more universal post-secondary education to deal with these forces. So we've got more experience. I think the other thing we shouldn't discount, though, is that how effective we are at making decisions collectively is going to be important in this new environment. We haven't figured everything out. We're going to have to adapt and respond. And it could be that there's this general phenomenon that existing organizations, existing firms get less agile. There's a law called Cardwell's Law that no nation remains on the innovative frontier for very long. So those forces argue at least for not being complacent.
Yep.
We're on the edge of where everybody's going to have to go. We've done a good job at it so far, but we should watch out for kind of ossification and a loss of agility. And if you want to see where this really bites, I mean, look at construction. We're just hopelessly uncompetitive in any construction project right now because of the time it takes us to do things in the United States compared to other parts of the world. Just build a subway, build a power plant, I mean, anything, which is just unbelievably expensive. And that's a problem we've made for ourselves, and we should learn how to copy some of the other players who are much better at this.
Given that you started asking questions, I have a question for you, Andrew.
No, because I want to hear you. You're part of the McKinsey Global Institute, so can you talk about, you know, like,
let me ask a question first, and then we'll get back there, because it has actually built on a little bit on that question of the globalization. Because frankly, Moore's Law is a miracle, because there's so many different ways that has happened. There's nothing that proves it's the case. And I'm actually not worried from the technology side with the three stacking that we will actually, technologically, we could potentially deliver that. But one of the things that worries me, frankly, on the innovation game is that incentives for people to invest on new R&D may be different than they were in the last 50 years. Not only are the growth prospects coming from population growth rising, but also a lot of the rise in consumer demand is coming from very low income segments. So they are looking for not just the latest technology, which used to be the case for our market, particularly on the West Coast where I live, but they are looking for the low cost products. That is the part that worries me. Does that worry you?
You want the good news or the bad news?
Both. I want your view.
I think the worrying news is that in a lot of countries in the rich world, the U.S. in particular, federal investment in R&D is clearly on the downslope, and I can't tell a happy story about that. You know, we talk about eating our own seed corn, and I think there is some of that going on. I find it just a denial of responsibility not to be doing that basic R&D, which has led to things like the internet, for example. So that downslope is kind of worrying to me. I don't know how worried to be about it. The good news is that the tools of fundamental innovation, the tools of really doing powerful new stuff, because of Moore's Law, are getting so much cheaper and so much more widely distributed that you don't, for some fields, not for all of them, but for some fields, you don't need the hundreds of millions of dollar government finance lab to do some really powerful stuff. So when I look at what's happening in fields like artificial intelligence and machine learning and sensing and robotics, it'd be nice to have bigger budgets, but you can do powerful stuff on a much smaller budget. Yeah. And I do think we're in an era of industrial R&D, maybe not back to where we were with AT&T and Bell Labs and things like that, but the great web companies are investing heavily and doing really, really cutting-edge stuff. In the field of machine learning, they have lured a lot of the leading talent away from universities to come work at Baidu, Google, Facebook, Apple, places like that. So that makes me encouraged about innovation.
And is Chinese government investment on R&D, which is clearly on a heavy upswing, is that taking the place of the US?
That's a question for you.
I hope it will, actually, because one of the wonderful things about the US investment is that it was very explicitly designed to be an enabler for proto-commercial applications, and I think that has been a real wonderful structural feature that has made it such a global growth driver. And I think there is no reason other governments couldn't do the same.
You know, let me cite just two examples, one that should make you feel good about how innovation is working. If you look at mobile telephony, this was astonishing in terms of how rapidly the technology developed in the United States. From as far as I can tell, almost entirely, you know, private investments. And then how amazingly rapidly it spread throughout the entire world. Yeah. The diffusion lag was much shorter on this one than before. So this makes you feel like this more decentralized market, large market opportunity can really drive things very, very successfully.
It's also an example of how unpredictable things are, because remember in 2007, the world's biggest mobile the leaders in telephony were Nokia and Motorola.
Right, exactly.
And other companies were absolutely dead in the water, and the center of innovation had moved to Europe, and we were all wringing our hands about that. Doesn't that seem quaint now?
And it does remind you this basic truism that you know the policy should not be to protect firms. Right. Firms come, firms go. Who cares?
But think how often we're lose. Think how often we lose sight of that. Yeah. Think of the war that Uber has to fight city by city to allow that innovation to happen.
Sure. Sure.
Well,
just to give the counterweight, I think there are some areas where more organized collective R&D is very important. If you take the threat of global warming, a low-cost nuclear power may be an option that we want to have access to. There's some challenges, but it may be an option we want to have access to. Right now, the problem with nuclear power is not waste storage, it's not fuel, it's the capital costs of the plants. And there would be ways to use smaller scale, reproduce exactly, lots of different ways to radically reduce the cost of the capital of a nuclear power plant. And one of the unfortunate side effects of fracking, which has been a huge success on many dimensions, is it's just completely taken all of the wind out of any innovation that we were doing about smaller module nuclear reactors here in the United States.
So because of that, we're relying on Elon Musk to do a lot of funding for fundamental battery research and energy storage research. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm glad he's there, but please, let's also fund that in our great universities, because research universities in the States are still the crown jewels of federally sponsored R&D.
But just one last point on this, which is that the only place in the world which is going to invest at scale in nuclear in a way where you could move down the learning curve and get the cost down is China. Hmm. So this is partly a response to your earlier question. Yeah. How do we feel about like the Chinese threat? I mean, the Chinese threat may be the thing that saves the planet. It's not necessarily a bad thing that we've got a lot of innovation now taking place in a lot of parts of the world. Now, I cut you off, so.
No, exactly building on the same thing, and to your point about the dynamism of the businesses, and this is actually a good news story. When you look at the global large companies, we looked at the companies with a billion or more in revenues globally. Mm. 3/4 of those are today in the Western world. But we expect that number to rise to 15,000 by 2025, so almost doubling. And 7 out of 10 of those new companies are going to be based in the emerging world.
What kinds of industries?
This is obviously this was done basically on cities and the kinds of patterns we see on the past. So we can't really tell you exactly what companies are. And I know for this crowd, I would be very scared to say that. But most of these companies, the huge large majority, are going to be companies whose names none of us have heard of. Yeah. They are already operating someplace. They are probably based in a city you have never heard of and you couldn't put in a map. Yet these are going to be companies that are going to, little by little, going to transform different industries. Many of them in China, for example, they have a huge domestic market that allows them to experiment and grow to a scale completely under any one of our radar and become really, really successful in something we don't necessarily even think about just yet. And just to illustrate the scale of this, you know all what the largest shopping day is, right? It's not Black Friday, because of course Cyber Monday has surpassed that a long time ago, but it's not Cyber Monday either. Last year, Cyber Monday, US consumers bought about $2.6 billion worth of goods. But the world's biggest shopping day was 3 weeks before the Singles Day in China, when the revenues of Alibaba alone were over, wait for it, $9 billion. So this just tells you that when we are seeing these companies are rising in markets that work in a very, very different environment than we do. They need to innovate in different ways. And I think that's going to be the exciting and good story. So I think I'm coming back to the same place where you were, Paul. The solution is going to come from places we have really no clue right now.
I think it's just like this notion that there's two different things. There's Moore's Law and globalization. I think recognizing there are lots of different kinds of technological change that could improve our lives, some of which work very well based on market incentives, others where I think there's a very important role for the government. We're probably underinvesting in those ones where the government can be very helpful. I think one that is just staring us in the face is cybersecurity. We've got a brewing absolute disaster on this front. No single firm has an incentive to do the kinds of things that could actually make this problem much better. And unfortunately, our government is basically more worried about cyber spying and breaking security than actually giving us some way to do something which is secure. So we're basically like peasants in the Middle Ages. We got nobody to protect us, and we're looking for some serf like Apple or Google that will take us in and shelter us from a really risky world.
Okay, there's a third force going on that I think we need to talk about. In addition to globalization and technology, there is a narrative that's gaining force these days about another mega trend, which is essentially the hijacking of capitalism. And this is something you hear from folk like Thomas Piketty. You've got another Nobel Prize winner, Joe Stiglitz, talking about large-scale rent-seeking and their version of what's going on. The story about this rise in inequality, the stagnating prospects, is a story about, to oversimplify, the elites changing the rules, locking in their position, and kind of excluding the rest of us. I want to hear what you two think of that narrative.
Okay. Well, one analogy that I find helpful is we really do require good governance to some degree. And if you think at the local level, one of the most important things the government does is protect you from crime. New York City right now is a city that does that relatively well. Detroit is a city that doesn't do that very well. And so a lot of people have left Detroit. A lot of people are moving to New York. Real estate is more valuable in New York. So it gives you a suggestion that competition between jurisdictions can actually be as useful a force as competition between political entities. So one of the ways, I think, to hold in check these kind of forces of capture, which always work through the mechanisms of governments, is just make sure there's lots of room for competition. So this argues against a lot of people's instinct, which is like, we gotta go to one world governance. Like in the financial sector, we gotta have a single unified worldwide system of financial regulation to avoid, you know, race to the bottom competition. I think this is absolutely wrong. That what we need is a financial system in Canada that's completely different from the one in the United States. And if the one in the United States blows up again and the one in Canada keeps working, we'll just start using the one in Canada. But we shouldn't try and force everybody in the world to follow what we do, because it may or may not turn out so well. So encourage competition at all scales as part of the way to hold that kind of capture risk in check. It's either capture or incompetence. Either side of
fools
of,
and knaves.
Of bad government can be a problem for us. So.
I violently agree with you that that's a critical question, not just because we care about it as a topic, but because it's a key question for global growth. We have benefited 1.7% of GDP growth every year for the last 50 years on average, simply because we have had more workers. That lift and raise is going to end. We are going to get 0.3%, less than a fifth of that in the next 50. So we basically are going to move into a very different growth scenario where everything that we see as growth is going to be coming in per capita income growth. Mm. And that means that we do need to care about these issues, even if you are less inclined to take it seriously from the social side, which I am. In full disclosure, I'm from Finland, so that I'm one of the Nordic countries, so we take this topic very seriously. But even if not, it is a key question for global growth. And I think it's a long debate, but I like to divide it into kind of two parts. One of them is what's the causes, and there are many causes. The shift of demand to services that are low wage, low productivity, there is technology, obviously. There is part of globalization, but it's probably less of an explanation. But I think, and we can spend a lot more, and I think we should spend more to understand that. But I think the question at the end of the day is that what to do about is quite separate from what the causes are. Independent of what the causes are, the allocation of resources is really a social and political question. And I think that's something that countries and nations will have to grapple. I think we will see changes on that because of the fact that the underlying economics are pressing in many directions towards more inequality. Are we going to let that happen or not? And I think that's the debate and a big challenge, and I think a big risk for global growth, yep, if we are not able to address it, not just in a sense of slower growth, but also in real risk in certain regions particularly.
But if I can kind of continue on this thread, I think that, you know, Stiglitz's conjecture about capture may or may not prove to be part of the story about what's going on at the very upper end of the income distribution, yep, like the 1%. But a lot of the pain associated with income inequality is in the middle and lower part of the distribution. And there, I suspect that this basic supply and demand force, that there are a lot more people who currently are willing to work for a lot less income who are available to compete on world markets right now. And I think that pure supply and demand force may be part of what we're grappling with right now. The good
news, and that's underlying the stagnation that we're experiencing at the 50th percentile, the 25th percentile.
Yeah, and you know, the good news about that is that it could be a painful transition for some time, but it will eventually correct itself, because what happened is we had populations with a very large fraction of, say, high school educated or less workers, very few college educated workers, who joined the North American population. We'd been working to raise the fraction of college-educated workers, so we're trying to make the high school-educated or less more scarce and make them have higher wages because they're scarce. And then we get this huge influx of people who are high school or less. As the rest of the world starts to invest in education just like we have, high school or less will become relatively scarce again and things will recover. But it could take a while. So if on the very long run, I think we can be optimistic if we do make the kind of investments in education, like the high school movement and then community colleges and so forth. So the long run, make those investments, stay optimistic, keep encouraging technological change. In the short run, think more carefully about what we can do to share the costs more evenly.
So let me take the pessimistic side of that argument.
Sure.
And you're talking about kind of the longer run. Yeah. We might get to a happy equilibrium. I think that's absolutely possible, and I'm really hopeful. My concern comes from the, over the longer run, that equilibrium is only going to be happy if people still have, at different levels of skill and education, yeah, if people still have a comparative advantage over different kinds of machines.
Right.
And I study machines. Mm-hmm. The more I look, the less confident I am that's going to be the case. There was a really cool NPR study, story. It was both online and on the radio, about the most common jobs in America. In the majority of states in 2014, the most common job was truck driver. That's not going to be the case in 15 or 20 years. It's just not going to be the case. So, Paul, I don't know where where the overall economic demand will come from. I don't know where the labor demand is going to come from at these different levels of skill to lead to that happy outcome. The one last little story I'll tell, short order cook or restaurant worker is a really very, very common job these days. It's not a great job. It's precarious. It's not very prestigious. We need a lot of that kind of labor. There's a video going around of a robot that can handle a head of cabbage now. And that sounds silly. Handling a head of cabbage is unbelievably difficult for any piece of automation to do. Everyone in this room can do it. Automation historically has been unable to handle an irregularly shaped, kind of flexible, weird thing like a head of cabbage. The way we're getting there is basically Moore's Law. The robot that can now pick up a head of cabbage and figure out how to slice it has 5 cameras on it, a bunch of sensors in the wrist, and a whole lot of processing power up in its brain to do something that any of us can do routinely. So when I take that kind of innovation and move that forward 15 or 20 years, my brain really hurts.
Yeah, no, I think this is, it was anticipating this conversation, which, by the way, we've never had a chance to meet, but, you know, we know
we clearly don't get along. This is the last conversation we'll have.
Right. But, you know, so we read each other's stuff. So it was actually this conversation that made me try and frame this in terms of Moore's Law versus globalization. Yep. Because if it's Moore's Law, it's robots that are basically just displacing most of the things humans can do, that presents a very worrisome long-run scenario for inequality. But on the other hand, if it really is a relative supply effect based on the fact that the rest of the world is invested less in education so far, it still takes a while to fix that, but it will self-correct. And I think the answer has to be both of these forces are operating and we don't know how big the relative contributions are. But I hope what you do take away from this is that they can both be operating and it makes a huge difference to what the future looks like, what the relative contributions of these two are. Now, I'm betting a little bit more on at least what we've seen so far in terms of, say, we've seen an enormous amount of manufacturing shift worldwide, and you know we've been seeing this for centuries. I'm betting that a lot of what we're seeing and suffering from is actually globalization. But I'll confess that when I used to give this argument in the classroom, what I always said was, and plus, think about things like driving a truck. You know, humans will always be the things that drive trucks. Yeah. We're never going to have a substitute for that.
True.
So, you know, take every forecast I give you with a little grain of salt.
Well, I want to take issue on the cabbage that everybody can do it. You do know that the most common accident in U.S. kitchens are done when people slice bagels. So I wouldn't. Cutting a cabbage is not as easy as it sounds. But I think to the question of where the jobs are going to come from, it is actually, we know it's something we can't tell. Because when you look at 25 years back, and you look at the net growth in all jobs since then, full third of those jobs are in occupations that didn't exist or barely existed 25 years ago. So this, of course, includes computer programmers and systems analysts, but also fitness instructors and medical technicians of all kinds. So by definition, there is no way we can tell where the jobs are going to come from. And that, I think, is the key question. In a way, one could even argue that if we focus on protecting the jobs, we are actually not putting our money on the innovations and finding the new jobs that we need. So one could argue that from the evidence from the past, from job growth perspective, what is much more important is to make sure we innovate and we create the third of the new jobs that third of the growth that are happening.
Yeah, trying to protect incumbent companies or job holders is a recipe for sclerosis and disaster.
What would have happened had we started doing that with the agricultural workers 150 years ago?
It's part of my job that I'm supposed to be a pessimist because I'm a licensed economist, but optimism just keeps breaking out. I'm sorry. You know, one thing that's critical to even the positive scenario I was describing is an effective educational system. And if you've followed educational reform, like the Goals 2000 panel, it actually looks pretty grim. But there's an analogy I like to invoke here, which is that if you thought about policing in the United States in the 1980s, even the early 90s, things looked very grim. We were just doing a terrible job at preventing crime.
And there was no prominent voice saying that things were about to get better.
Yeah.
Remember that? Everyone was saying, well, we ain't seen nothing yet.
Mm-hmm. But we actually saw a lot of very low-level basic management practices that changed in police departments. The most fundamental one was the recognition that you've got a certain number of man hours. You want to allocate the man hours to the places and the times where the crime is likely to be. And so having a gang task force that works Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, just turns out to not be a very good way to use man hours. but you reallocate and you can get huge, huge improvements. So we just when we're about ready to give up all hope that our government institutions can respond, the crisis gets bad enough and then we suddenly do respond. So, and the other thing is we know educational systems can be better because we've got Finland. You know, we know how good an educational
system
is.
We know
can
how
be.
Much room we have at the top. Just look at Finland. It's amazing how well. With this completely egalitarian, you know, not high cost educational system, and you guys are crushing it around the world.
And they are paranoid right now because we think we need to crush it tomorrow, and that's keeping up with many of the emerging markets, Beijing, Singapore, et cetera.
But to reiterate a theme in this, there's kind of the Moore's Law and globalization, but there's also stuff you can get the market to do and stuff where we really are going to rely on the government to do, and we got to get our governments to get better at doing things. And education is this make or break issue where we have to get better. But I think there's still time.
And it does look like dark days there, but I think you're exactly right. It's funny how things can turn a corner in a positive direction relatively quickly. One of the questions I always ask myself is, a decade ago, if somebody had told me that marriage equality and legal marijuana would be widespread in America, I would have laughed in their faces. And, you know, I'm straight and I don't smoke dope, but I think these are fantastic developments, completely unanticipated.
The other thing is to remind us why IT might be so important. When Bill Bratton took over in the police department in the first round under Giuliani, he asked, how long would it take me to get a report of all the crime in any given precinct? And it was something like many months before he could even find out what happened last weekend or the day before. That wasn't required even by the technology of the time, but now they've got daily updates with very high degree of geographic specificity of what's going on. So IT can help you just do basic things like allocate your person hours to the places where they're most valuable.
I must tell the story, because I was last week in LA hearing the deputy mayor tell the story of how they are doing exactly the data-driven management, and the communication learned from New York was, I loved it, which is put the cops on the dots, and dots were the crime spots. I thought that was such a succinct, perfect management communication.
Right. That's like professors are not allowed to be that clear. We have to obfuscate, and it's got to involve a word that ends in shun, like you know, allocation of. So we've got some questions that have come through. Let's see. So will can China replace the U.S. as the global leader in digital innovation? Who wants to take a swing at that one?
Could you say it again?
Will China displace the United States in digital innovation? And I guess you could interpret that either in hardware or software.
So let me take it first, Craig. I would say not in the short term. I'd say all bets are off in the medium to long term, especially because of the level and the scale of digital entrepreneurship that we're seeing in China, and the fact that these tools are so widely distributed and very widely available. We're seeing Chinese entrepreneurs and innovators do really, really interesting thing. But I had the chance to ask a flavor of this question at a panel a while back where Condoleezza Rice and David Petraeus were on the panel. And they were talking about cybersecurity and how deeply terrifying it was. So I asked them, who's winning the geek race? You know, the arms race is a little bit passe. Who's winning the geek race these days? And to my happy surprise, both of them said the U.S. is winning the geek race. We're educating some of them ourselves, but more importantly, people want to come, the geeks want to come here to build their lives and build their careers. And if you want to encourage crazy thinking and radical entrepreneurship, a totalitarian state is not always the best way to do that.
On the other hand, I can tell you that looking at it from the West Coast and from the investor perspective, I think there's a lot of bets being done in China. So I think actually who is winning doesn't really matter. I think both of them are going to be clear leaders, and the race is going to be good for all of us.
And to reiterate my point about nuclear power, if that one didn't work for you, think about pharmaceutical innovation. You know, when I'm on the verge of going senile and losing my brain, I don't care whether it's a Chinese doctor or a U.S. doctor or a European doctor that invents the pill that helps me retain my brain. I just want to have that pill. So the fact that we're going to have medical innovation all throughout the world with probably 10 times as many people doing it as we've had in the past, it just means they're more likely that we're going to have things that will improve the
quality
of our lives.
There was just an article in Wall Street Journal, I don't know if anybody read it this week, that talked about how China is outsourcing some of the professional healthcare, et cetera, jobs in the US. So it might be that offshore skilled services is going to be a new job growth area for US. Mm. Who would have guessed that a few years back?
In terms of other other questions, another good one is, so how does our collective excitement fit with the gloom spread by so many about secular stagnation? I guess as the macroeconomist, I should probably weigh in on this, which is, I think, basically, this is, for me, deja vu all over again. When I came into economics in the 1980s, it was post-stagflation, yep. It was the Reagan-Volcker recession, it was doom and gloom all across the board. We are way too responsive in our thinking about the long run to short-run events. So it's perfectly predictable that in the wake of another very bad short-run recession, that now we're all doom and gloom again about the long-run prospects. But I think this will prove to be just as wrong this time as it was in the 80s. Because remember, after the 80s, we had the 90s.
Can you identify what might kick us out of this low-growth period, particularly in Europe and North America?
Well, I think we've still got a very serious lingering kind of risk in Europe. We still don't know what will happen if Greece leaves the euro. And, you know, odds are it might be a non-event. But listen, I remember the weekend when we all knew that Lehman Brothers was going to go bankrupt, and a bunch of economists that you know well.
I think a bunch of folk in this room remember that weekend very, very clearly.
But I remember sitting around at a conference with a bunch of economists you know well, and we were all saying, you know, we've known this was coming. If this one doesn't go bankrupt, we're never going to let a firm go bankrupt. You know, it's not going to be that big that big a deal. That was Saturday. By Wednesday, it looked like we were on the edge of the chasm. So. It may not be a big deal if Greece leaves the euro, but we ought to remember the Lehman story and remember that we don't entirely understand how these systems are going to behave.
Well, I'll take the other side of you, Paul. You know, that actually worries me. Secular stagnation worries me, mostly because of the incentives. I mean, clearly, if we are investing on lowering costs rather than pushing the frontier, if we are actually having our income distribution be so that the money goes not to the pockets of folks who are spending it, but to the pockets who are people who are already saving and looking for a way to invest, I think it is something that it worries me. And I think we need something to jolt us back. But economics is all about animal spirits. I have lived through, for example, I study a lot of the emerging markets. So I went through the NAFTA boom in Mexico, watching it in the 1990s, the China boom in 2000s. I think all we need is a real collective trust that things are going to be all right, and I think they can turn around. But it does worry me, because it can sustain. There are examples of Japan and everywhere else where this can go on for a long time.
But Paul, whether or not you agree with Larry Summers' secular stagnation concerns, you probably agree with his prescription, which is let's invest in infrastructure, let's do some stuff that might stimulate some growth.
Mm-hmm. Yep, the consensus view about stabilization policy, so not the trend, but just keeping us close to the trend, the consensus view was that government could get us back sooner, but the economy will naturally go back anyway. There's a growing sense, and I think the right way to interpret this secular stagnation view is the government may have to be even a little bit more active in this process than we thought, but there are some very sensible ways to be active. And in particular, buy infrastructure when it's cheap. It's the best.
Isn't it mind-boggling that we're not doing that?
Yeah.
It makes no sense. In our book, which I agree with Tim, you should all buy it. Let's just be clear about that. But in our book...
His book, you buy it when it's expensive, not when
we talk about the Econ 101 playbook as the right thing to do, exactly to signal how uncontroversial these things are. So investing in infrastructure, liberalizing our immigration policies, getting our educational system right, these are complete no-brainers among every mainstream economist that you or I know. And yet we're doing, I'd say in the States, we're doing it at a sea level or way, way below. The Society of Civil Engineers, I think, gave us a D+ on our last infrastructure report card. Buy it when it's cheap.
Yep. And this is where I think the crisis in Europe is already having a negative effect, which is that Europe is worried about deficits and austerity. They're not thinking about gee, this is a perfect time to invest in a bunch of valuable infrastructure. The U.S. has our political divide, which is holding us back. We just don't have somebody in the world who could actually demonstrate, except China, frankly. I mean, China did this with the high-speed rail in a very big way.
They do it over and over. Yeah. I flew from Shanghai to New York yesterday, and I always heard Tom Friedman in the back of my head. Tom is the world master at summarizing these things in a really cool way. He said flying from Shanghai to JFK is like going from the Jetsons to the Flintstones. It's not right.
But on China, the thing to remember is they did two things that actually made their economy respond very effectively to this huge shock of the financial downturn. One was use the banking system to finance a lot of real estate development. And that still is working itself out and is a little bit risky. But the other thing they did is make this massive investment in infrastructure with the high-speed rail, and this is going to pay off hugely for them. So this is the part we should be copying. Yeah. We have reached our 2:15 plus a half time limit, so I think we should probably call it a day, but thank you for giving us a chance to talk to each other, and maybe we'll even do it again.
Well, thank you. Thanks a lot, everyone.